massive. Greetings once again. We are back in the session. Thank you for holding forth and staying tuned up to now. And just like promised, you know, we have the next great artist right here with us tonight. Greetings, Elijah Prophet.
Blessed love, my lad. Enough love and respect to each and everyone who is listening and who is not listening. Bless up on yourself. Thanks for the support and everything. Big up, my brother.
Up, up, up. I mean, it's been one artist after the other, but a lot of my fans, or those who are Greg Rising fans, not just my fans, they've been saying, when is Elijah Prophet coming in? I said, yeah, we need to wait a little, you know. Good things come to those who wait, so give thanks to have you, my brother.
Give thanks, man. Give thanks. And thanks to you for holding.
See, so where are you speaking to us right now from, Elijah? Which part of the world?
I'm speaking from my living room in Jamaica, in the sunny Jamaica. Nice and sunny.
You see that massive from Elijah's yard to your yard, and you guys are watching from Onuyatu, I hope. Yeah, Elijah, I mean, I'm speaking to you from Germany anyway, and I got to know your works while here in Germany, because you have worked with a lot of German producers and have been on the stage here in Germany. But let's leave Germany for now. Tell us, introduce yourself to your fans, so many of them who have been itching to hear you and see you tonight.
Excuse me, can you repeat?
I said, just introduce yourself, tell the people who you are, where you're speaking to us from.
Oh, all right. My name is Elijah. I am Elijah Prophet, as you all know, but my real name is Devon St. Patrick Hogarth. I was born in Westmoreland, in Jamaica. I'm now living in Kingston, Jamaica. I'm living off Windward Road, and I'm in my living room in Kingston, nice, warm, and sunny, and sending blessing to each and everyone, and sending some warmness and love to everyone.
All right. Massive, when you hear that, you know, Elijah Prophet in the house, speaking to you all from Kingston, Jamaica. Elijah, tell us, I mean, your musical career picked up from somewhere in Jamaica there. Has it always been Kingston, or from most Westmoreland where you're originally born?
No, I started recording from Ocherius with Courtney Cole. And then when Garnet Silk died, I came to Kingston, because then it wasn't Elijah Prophet, it was Devon Hardware. And I got the name from the same person who gave Luciano, Buju Banton, and Sizzler and all that guy's name. Homer Harris is the person who gave me, he was a part of the group who gave me the name Elijah Prophet in Kingston. When I came to Kingston, that was, I think it about, I don't quite remember the year. It's been so long.
All right. I mean, you worked a lot with the great Gunners before he passed on our transition. How was that? Because
I was around him. I wasn't really doing any work at then. I was around Garnet, Utah and Green and all the others. Everton Blender and everybody. I used to be around them as a little soldier. Yeah. They know I'm a good singer, and they always tell me to me that one day you will make it, you, which I do appreciate.
True. You were then taken to Courtney Cole's Roof Talent by Garnet, yeah?
Yes.
And this is where, you know, your voice and your confidence behind the microphone was kind of seen by me.
Grow, yeah.
Yeah, seen. So after that, when you moved to Kingston, where did you first do your first production then? Which studio and who was on that?
All right. When I came to Kingston, I was at Grove Road, where Caveman Sound System was. That's Mr. Lloyd Evans, his place. He had a building there, and he always make sure that artists, even though there wasn't a living quarters, we all stayed there. There was no bed or anything, but it didn't matter to me, because I had a dream, and my dream is to please the world, let the world feeling happy about themselves, even if I am not. My dream was to make people happy with music.
And you've been doing that, you know. You've worked with some great producers also, you know, and great studio people like Jimmy Haynes. And you say Caveman Sound, the great Caveman Sound, you were also in that tutelage. But you kind of, you know, move outside Jamaica with your music somehow, because in Germany here you are so well recognized. I mean, I work with Einemann. Einemann was a former selector with Caveman Sound.
Caveman, and yeah.
When I told Annie the other day, I said, Annie, I'll be on a Zoom meeting with Elijah. I said, my brethren, that, you know. We know him from long time, Chidi. He said, yo. He said, yeah. Ask him, man. Tell him, say, we know him, man, from long time. So you have been working with...
Yeah, man, so definitely.
You work with Popo and with some good...
Well, let me explain. Annie, man, was one of the person who was there when I win the Stone Love Star Search. I think it was 1996. I win Stone Love Star Search as a singer, as one of the first singer to win Stone Love Star Search, to be exact.
Boom.
I win Stone Love Star Search 1996. And Einemann and the others, John the Baptist, Black Warrior, and all those other guys, they were there for supporting me as a upcoming talent, and I proved myself to be what I am. And I move on to work with Jimmy Hines, Chris Records, Stone Love, Weep Bow, because I record some song for Stone Love as well. And Kennedy International. I work with a lot of producers.
True. And you also highly recognized in outside Europe, actually, not Jamaica, but in Canada. You have a great, massive fan following in Canada. How did you get yourself into that scene? You know, because Canada is a very tough, you know, but you
all right.
Okay, good man. Tell us about this then.
I won the Tamika Award 1996 as well.
See?
With me and Major P, we win Tamika Award in 1996 with Major P. See Them From Afar. That song won the Tamika Award in 1996. And that gave me a good break in Canada. And I started to work in with a lot of producers. Even like 3 years ago, I recorded a song with for a Canadian producer, which is called Jermaine. Another Mother Cry, which did well for me in Germany. And, you know, I record for a few producers in Canada. And I speak with a lot of people, like promoters and most of all, disc jocks from Canada. So, you know, it's growing in Canada. I wouldn't say it reached the maximum, but it's growing in Canada and I am happy. And Spotify proved that to me, that my massive in Canada is very large.
For real? I checked that out, you know. Adami, I said, wow, Canada too, because I know say Canada have a very strong reggae scene. And most Jamaican artists penetrate the US scene easily, but somehow getting into the Canadian scene is tough. You see a very popular artist in the US, but in Canada, when you check through the ratings, you find out that the artist is not so well known there. So I think the DJs and
I never been to Canada. I never perform in Canada. I never perform in Canada. Never.
You're making impact there through the DJs. I was just saying the DJs and the radio station, they are playing your song strongly. That's probably one of the things that got you, you know, to be well recognized there. And this is great. So now the world is kind of restricted through traveling. It's not easy to reach out to your fans all over the world, but I know that so many are following your music. So,
yeah, I'm still doing it somehow because, you know, I release a lot of songs for the past. Well, I took a break after having some issues, family problems and things like that. I got remarried 6 years ago. Okay. I divorced, got remarried 6 years ago, and I started pushing as hard as I can now, because I'm working with some people from Spain, some people from Canada still, and I'm working with some people from Costa Rica, and I'm doing some work with some Brazilian and Panama, as you know. But the album that I'm doing right now, it's from Costa Rica. It's production from Costa Rica, as well as I'm working with some new producers in Jamaica. But the Costa Rican project, which they put me, they have a Spanish album. That album was totally for Spanish people. I actually break the ice by being the first and only Jamaican to be on that Spanish album, which is only pure English.
Wow. Up. Yeah.
Yeah.
What about Africa? Have you been to travel there, or have you
any artists
so far from the continent?
But I mean, almost every single person I spoke to from that part of the world knows all my songs, because I remember I was watching someone send me something off YouTube a couple of years ago when they released King of Kings, and they were playing the Gentleman and the Elijah Prophet in a dance, and that was the song the people were dancing to. And also I found out that Mother Nature was a big song in Africa, very, very huge song in Africa, that they even re-edit the song with pictures of the kids from Africa. And I'm so honored until today to see something like that, because I know that these people are really thinking about Elijah Prophet. I'll tell you the truth, I lost faith in the music industry because of so many bad things that is happening. People who I work with are canceling my shows and things. But, you know, the same people from Africa who influenced me said, hey, you're one of the greatest singers we know, and we haven't heard anything from you lately. What are you doing? And that strengthened me, and I give thanks for that.
Yeah, I want to tell you that I have a sound system in Africa too, Iroko sound system, and I play Elijah Prophet, and the sound is there, even though I'm in Germany, and they play Elijah Prophet still. That's why I was asking if you've been there.
I'll give thanks.
You have a great fan following also there, and we can't wait to have
it.
It's going to manifest very soon.
I can't wait to be there, my brother.
Yes, for real.
I can't wait to be there.
So we are going to bust our next tune now from Elijah Prophet, thing called Piece of Ganja. Listen to this, Massive.
Just a good say, so yes. Meditation for the brain. Only weed, no cocaine.
Yes, smoke the say, so yes. The truth it is, I have to confess. Officer, nobody charge me. Smoke my piece of ganja.
Globally.
Yeah.
This song is a global hit song.
So I'll tell you something that you didn't know. Tell me.
This song is bigger in Russia than anywhere else in the world.
In Russia?
Yes. All right. I didn't have a Spotify account all these years. And suddenly Spotify sent some messages, and my guys who was in Costa Rica, they deal with all my Facebook and everything, and Spotify told me I need to claim this channel that they created, which was my Spotify channel.
Wow.
And we start to see like 28,000 the very first week. I said, what? 28,000 stream, and it grows. When I get the end of the year Spotify WAPs, I got Spotify WAPs for the year.
Whoa.
And this song stream over 200 countries. Over 200 countries. And it was on 60 something different mixes per day.
Wow.
And
his
fan base on top was Russia. Germany was second, America. No, like Russia, America, then Germany.
Big. Hey, massive. You have to pull it up straight from the top one more time. Drink our piece of ganja. Elijah Prophet. Big tune. Tearing places.
Yes, Mama says, oh yes, the truth it is, I have to confess. I've been no bad chance. It's more fun.
Yes, my brother.
Yes, I.
Who produced this track then?
Ah, now I will give you people who don't know this. This is us. All right, before I go further, there's two different versions of this song that wasn't done by me. Two different Russian person between Russia and Eastern Europe redo over this song. The Velvet Bears, as I think they are, and I don't remember the next young lady name who covered this song. But the producer is from Austria.
Wow.
Irie Vibration.
Okay. Not Jamaica.
And this rhythm, yeah, this rhythm even supposed to be a part of a production. It happened that they played it by mistake and I heard it and I said, I like it. They said, you're not working with this rhythm. But I insisted to voice the song, and when they heard it, they said, wow. And this is how this rhythm get to be recorded, because they didn't plan to record it any at all. Like they told me.
So let's speak about the herbs. You is an herbs defender. And then we found
yes.
that Jamaica a couple of years ago, not too long, decriminalized the holy plant. So how do you see the role of ganja in Jamaican economy today? Because we see the whole world now. Canada, we just talked about, legalized the other day. And so how do you see ganja and its economical benefit to Jamaica, knowing that a couple of years or decades ago, a lot of Rasta people and people were brutalized by the government because of this same thing. Some were sent to prison. So how do you see this transformation that has taken place in Jamaica over the herbs?
All right. The dishonest part of it is that it's not for the poor or people who fight to, like Peter Tosh, who fight to make ganja become one of Jamaica's greatest products. My grandfather, Ezra Willie, got arrested and they told him they're going to trim him. And he said, if you're locking me up, you can't trim me. And if you trim me, you can't lock me up because you guys don't have any proof that this thing is anything that harms anybody. But the reality about it is that it's only the corporate society who got benefits from the decriminalizing of the herbs right now.
Okay. So
the poorer class don't get anything from it. They still charge you for it if they catch you with it still.
Really?
Yeah.
Okay. So how is then the Rasta community or the local farmers, how are they dealing with this challenge then? Is there a structure set up to incorporate them or bring them into the benefits? Because they have been the one keeping the goods all these years, you know, going through the rigors, fighting the system.
Yeah, they're the one.
Them. Is there any structure? Because you is a person that has the power to talk to millions. Your music is played all over the world. Is there a structure that is being set up today? Artists like you and also advocates of the herb to help change that, you know, that situation right now in Jamaica.
Let us be clear on this. In Jamaica right now, the moment you start fighting for the truth, you are at risk. If you know what I mean.
True.
You're at risk because the corporate society don't want anybody to dictate or to tell them, hey, what you're doing is wrong. They think whatever they do, it's okay. Because they don't really care about the people. They care about money. Nobody think about the people. None whatsoever.
Okay. Then this is a sad situation, you know, but then... You, as well as other herb ambassadors out there, I see it as a challenge for you people now to, like, you know, form a strong platform legally you have to address
it.
Go on.
Well, I am doing that in some songs right now because the upcoming album, there's two songs on it that will open the doors so people can see behind the wall.
Right.
There's two ganja songs on that album that will open the door to show behind the wall what's really going on. Because, like I said, even now you can be arrested for spliff still, which is downright crazy.
That is sad. That is sad, my people. You know, hear that? Even in the great Jamaica, where you know, or at least,
because even the commissioner of the who deal with the WAF back then, who resigned, he's a part of the industry who have license to ship weed. You know what I mean?
Okay.
So it just goes to tell you that everything is just pure hypocrisy. And I don't see the sense for them legalizing it and it only becomes something for the rich, which the rich people don't really smoke herbs. It's the poor man who smoke herb. It's the poor man who plant herbs.
Or at least has been planting it before. Now they jump upon it and stuff they plant because they have the big bag of money to set up the big plantation.
Right. And they used to hunt us as Rastas who live in the hills and plant weed, and they send in the helicopters, some from the US, some from here, some from all over the place, to destroy the weed. But at the end of the day, the same thing that you fight against, now you're saying it's okay because it's benefiting you now.
Yes. Even then it was benefiting them, but they didn't want to accept that because they were promoting other things. But right now we are going to take a little musical now and play something from Elijah Prophet thing called Soul Seekers Massive. Listen to this big tune again.
Yes, I.
It is part of the thing you are strongly into. Can you try a bit of like, were your parents Rasta or you just embraced it out of your own request?
All right, my grandfather, like I said, Ezra Willie was a Rastafari from Westmoreland. Granduncles, grandmother, everybody used to be a natty. Well, some of them, I think even back then, my father used to be a Rasta, which he cut his hair and he went to America and he live a good life. He's dead now still, but he live a good life then. And my mother, I think she used to be a Rasta. I didn't know her as a Rasta. I only heard about it. You know what I mean? But my faith in Rastafari increases when I start to see the different treatments between people, because I grew up in church as a choir boy. I was a choir boy.
Okay.
And when the fighting started for... Yeah, I grew up as a choir boy. And started to sing in churches. What changes that... When they start to fight amongst each other, I was even involved in the fighting because people was deciding who should have this position and who should have that position. That's when I tell myself, this is not for me. Because you can't be about the Almighty and you're trying to fight against yourself. It doesn't make any sense.
True.
The only thing I never do, I never deny the Almighty, but I deny the followers who are misleading the people. So, you know, I and until today, I've seen so many people using the name of God to trick people out of what they have and to destroy people's freedom with the name of God, as it was then, as it still is now. So my stand against religion is not about Christianity, about Rastafari. I don't deal with religion. I deal with liberty. I deal with life.
That's good to know, because I come from a country where we have the biggest amount of churches in the whole world, Nigeria. But then again, what you see happening there, the exploitation from the churches, from the so-called men of God or women of God, it's appalling. It's a shameful thing. But I myself grew up in a very strong churchical family, if I have to use that word. Actually, my parents wanted that I become a priest, a Catholic priest. So I went to a special school, the seminary school, where they trained me to be a priest. But through my rebellious way, I had to cut out from the school and try to find itself. And part of the reason why I left the school was just what you just said. You know, you see people, you see the hypocrisy in those who are supposed to, you know, lead people or help people discover their
be a leader. Yeah.
So these are the things that I experience. So I can kind of resonate with that, you know, you say. But we're gonna take another tune now, because this one is straight to their head, you know.
But if I tell you this, would you believe me? My wife is a trained pastor.
Wow. You see that? This is serious. But yeah, this is how it goes, because like
said,
it's not the religion, it's the soul of the person. Like this tune is saying, soul seeker. So
definitely,
when you seek out the right soul, it doesn't matter what kind of spiritual journey or religious lifestyle the person is, the soul that is important, is the liberty, you know, not what actually
definitely, man.
Yeah, so I can relate with that.
Not what's surrounding it. Yeah.
Not what's surrounding it. It's just the soul of the person. So and that said, I want to give a warning
that is important
who are like exploiting the spirit, or those in the name of God who are exploiting it with this track from Like a Prophet, Think of Warden. The lyrics is straight, you know. Yeah, all of them. So, but now in Jamaica, you know, we still hear the little island of Jamaica. We still hear a lot of violence going on, you know, and you know, tracks like this.
Yeah.
So tell me, how is this? I mean, how you coping with this reality of where you are, you know, and try to get along still with your musical thing, with the violence. I mean, the level of violence taking place in the island.
Well, the reality about life is, you know, that regardless of what the situation is, you will have to survive. And you have to, and if you live for the Almighty God, it's only the Almighty God can pull your expired date.
True.
Because each of us have an expired date, just like a tin of mackerel or a tin of sardine. It's just that the expired date is not written on our back. See what I'm saying? So what happened is that you just have to just give thanks to the Almighty and continue to do what you have to do and do your works and do it potently. Do it willingly, do it with love, with respect, continuously. So for me, I already seen Jamaica coming to this. Over the years, I watched Jamaica growing to the root of this strand. And it's not because of the people, but it's because of the leaders and the people who are influential over the people. Because if you take these guys who have guns, they don't have any money. They're broke. They're living broke. So who give them these guns? It have to be somebody who in authority who have the money. And that is a reality. So when I got this rhythm from my brethren in Costa Rica, who they were producing the Spanish album, like I told you before, this is from the Spanish album. Everything else on this rhythm is Spanish.
Connection and Espanol, thank God.
Yeah.
I hope I did.
But I got it. I was chosen by them, and I was chosen by God as well. And God choose what I do on this rhythm, and I get the opportunity to tell the situation what we're facing. Because I remember some guys from social media who were talking about where Jamaica is heading to Mexico dimension. And people say he's stupid. But we live to see we've surpassed Mexico as a murder capital. And that can't be anything good. Because until we wake up and come to the reality that whatever we are doing it wrong, it will never change. Because this murder thing is going on in Jamaica. They're using it as a business. The funeral homes are making money. The person who built coffins are making money. The people who work is making money. They don't really care. So it's up to us to make that change. We can't use them to make that change because there's no change for them because they're making more and more money. So the reality is the crime in Jamaica, it's hectic, but I can't sit and worry about it because I have to continue living life. And like I said, if that's the way I should go, then I'll go that way. But if that's not the way, Jah won't let it be that way.
See, yeah, you ain't going nowhere until Jah say you have a go. Because I know human being bring
exactly
you, or that bring you here can always say when you are to go. So we don't worry about that. And I'm happy you don't worry about that and let that stop in your musical journey, you know, if I may use that word. Seeing now coming to where we are today, Greg Isaac Foundation project. How did you get into this project, Elijah?
It was a part of Tommy Kush, I guess Tommy Kush Fire, and maybe Dewey. Let me be honest to you. I just know like 2 days before that, oh, this project and they need one more person, and you are the person who they wanted on it. I didn't know anything else. But Gregory Isaac, for me, I remember when we go to the small island with Gregory Isaac and Dennis Brown, the promoter was telling me like $500 for the show. And Jimmy Hines agreed. But when we went to Trinidad, Gregory Isaac, you know, he had this voice. He said, hey, you think he's a fool singing here? You have to give him some more money. And he demanded some money for me, and I got what he thinks I deserved from the same promoter. And, you know, for me to sing on a tribute to Gregory Isaac, It's more than an honor. It's more than an honor. I mean, Gregory has done so much for reggae music. I don't care about what people say bad about him. I can tell you the good things about him. He make reggae music what it is today also. They all play a part and he play his part as well.
That said, you know, Marcy.
And the intro of the song was put together by my wife. The intro.
Yeah, I'm going to hear this intro himself. Elijah Prophet, Greg Isaac Knight, North Reading, thing called Like a King.
She makes me feel like a king.
Delivery there, Elijah. Trust me, man.
So the Empress. Give thanks, man.
See.
Yes, man.
All right. The brother, has been an honor, great, great honor speaking to you, watching you live.
Same here, my brother.
Years I've been listening to your music, and the GI Foundation gives me the honor to be with you face to face. Though digitally, but
well,
spiritually.
Likewise,
yeah.
I honor them a lot. The Gregory Isaac Foundation. Mm-hmm. I can say this loud and I can say it clearly. Whatever you have, whatever projects you have, whenever you want me to do something, doesn't matter who I work with, I am yours.
You're coming to Nigeria soon, man. Don't watch nothing, man. Me tell you already, you know.
I'm looking forward to meet the eye physically.
You're launching the foundation.
I'm really looking forward.
You're launching the foundation, though, visually, in July, the Kuru last X-Strong, yeah? And I'm going to keep you in the loop. I'm going to see how things happen as we progress. It's going to be a visual launch because of the COVID thing anyway. It's not going to be a physical launch. But I'll keep you in the loop.
All right.
GI Foundation would definitely love and be honored to have you in that project in July. So,
all right. I had some new numbers. I had some new phone numbers. So you just link me up on Facebook and I will send you my information. All right.
Up for me, brother. So may I go pull it up one more time because this tune here, you don't know, like a king, you know. Yes.
And let me say to the whole world right now who is watching, listening, and look at Elijah Prophet. It couldn't be possible without all you guys. It could never be possible without any of you guys. And I thank you guys for believing in me. I thank you guys for supporting me. I thank you guys for looking out for me each and every day. And to the whole entire world, I'm just saying lots of love from Elijah Prophet. And I mean it sincerely.
Massive, you know, hear that from the prophet himself, you know, to answer Elijah Prophet. And if you go check the Bible in and know who Elijah Prophet actually is, so you can know that what's coming from this brother cannot be anything less than pure truth and reality. So when he say love, love him, I give you. And the same way, Elijah Prophet, we are sending love to you and your family where you are. Stay safe. The Almighty to keep you in shelter, and then keep on doing what you love to do and what we love to see and listen to. Hopeful, honor to have you, my brother. Straight from the top, one
give
more
thanks. Time,
the king himself, like a king, and bigging up the empress, who wasn't it? Think called.
She makes me feel like a king. And when I